Cold Frosty Morn.
Yep.
Okay.
One, two.
As long as I can remember, I've wanted to make a record with my dad. He's the one who taught me how to play. You know, and we made a couple little recordings, but we never really made a record. You know, I've been burning up and down the highways the last 10, 12 years, and as time slips away like that, you start thinking, man, I need to make time to make this record. But then the tours get booked, and I'm on the road, you know, 200 some days a year.
Pinched.
Yeah. And man, you know, so I just kind of looked at my schedule one day and looked at a empty spot in some month on the calendar and said, this is it. This is when we need to block off and just go make this record.
Hey, Dad.
Where's that kid of mine? You want to get back a little bit, don't you?
Yeah. I'm stealing a swig of your coffee.
You are, ain't you?
It's been something that's been on my mind forever and kind of like a bucket list thing. It's like, you know, he taught me how to play. He's my dad. Of course, I want to make a record with him and revisit the songs that he taught me when I was a kid and just kind of, in a way, revisit my childhood. You know, there's that whole side of it, but there's also the just wanting to kind of showcase his talent, which is real and honest and real grassroots kind of player, you know. I've always loved that about him. It's kind of the musician's musician, you know, the guitar player's guitar player. I mean, he's a great player and singer. He's one of the best I've ever heard, the best. I grew up hearing that every day.
My grandfather and my mother all played and sang. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it took off from there.
Yeah.
My music just all by ear. All by ear.
I know you spent a lot of time partying with Grandpa out in that garage. What was those jams like?
Just any old country song, mostly Hank Jr. and Willie Nelson songs. He loved Willie.
I just remember him playing with his thumb and stuff when I was little. He'd sing.
He never did the pick thing.
Yeah, he just played with his thumb.
Yeah. You know, he was like a strummer, old-timey music. You know, like, we three live all alone. We're not even company. My echo, my shadow, and
me. Oh, wow.
Stuff like that, ragtime stuff.
Damn.
And country and western.
So, you know, the first part is all Mele. And then whenever I get to this part, I just kind of...
Not quite, Ronnie. I know you want to get after it, but you gotta wait. Okay, go ahead.
Some of these songs I probably was hearing before I can remember. I mean, even as early as when I was 3 years old, I remember sitting in my high chair and you guys sitting around picking tunes, and who knows what they were playing back then, but possibly some of these tunes. And by the time I was 4, 5, 6 years old, he was showing me tunes like Beaumont Rag and Salt Creek and Long Journey Home and, you know, a bunch of those tunes that you could play in G, C, and D with the capo.
Yeah, yeah.
And sitting there on the bed picking those little tunes and, you know, when I should be sleeping because I got school the next day, but man, I was really getting my real lessons at night picking with you.
Yes, you were.
Last of the Mohicans.
Yes, that's the movie.
Honey.
Soundtrack.
Xena Warrior Princess? Okay, this is badass. Look at that. Xena Warrior Princess. Liar, liar, hearts on fire. Dude, this is badass. I gotta take this one.
Wait a minute.
Oh, the traveling Wilbur, yeah.
He always would make a point to really sit me down and show me stuff. Hey man, this is, you know, Doc Watson. This is, you know, David Grisman. This is Black Sabbath. This is Johnny Winter. This is King Crimson.
And Jimi Hendrix.
You know? Yeah,
this,
yeah, exactly. I mean, He was my teacher.
Yeah, I was like a little sidekick, like you'd show me music and shit. That was,
Because you had the talent.
I remember he did that same thing for Black Sabbath, like, and
yeah, so
that was probably a year later.
Show you something that's real, man.
And it's I was terrified.
Yeah, he was.
Dropped the needle on that shit, and it's like, what is this that stands before me? Figure in black, which points at me? You know, like, talking, describing Satan and, like, all these, like, bells and storms, and it was just like, let me the fuck out of here.
When did you start getting into bluegrass and stuff?
When I started going down south with Dad and getting it down here in these hills and heard the Grand Ole Opry for the first time, and that's when I started falling in love with that.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And just coming down where the radio picked it up, you mean?
Yep, where the radio picked it up in the truck.
It's just always been part of our family, like for as long as I can remember, music was just part of it. It was just like eating breakfast in the morning. There was nothing else that I was interested in. It was like, you know, if you were a professional golfer or something, or even a passionate golfer, I probably would have been into golf.
Yeah.
But he likes bass fishing and picking bluegrass, so that's what I like to do too.
Yeah, that's exactly.
You know.
Because, when not only did we pick music, mm-hmm. but I had a bass boat too, and me and him and his brother, we were fishermen.
Oh, yeah.
Every weekend we'd go fishing.
While walking one day in the country,
haven't seen Mary in years is, you know, directly inspired by Bill and James Monroe's version, but we just play it down like we would if we were sitting there picking at a campground or something, and just kind of do our little take on it.
I haven't seen Mary in years.
That's good. You got the first part out of the way. We don't need it again, I don't think. So now I just start on the chorus. Start on Hold My Hand and Lead Me.
Hold my hand and lead me.
It seems like you're restraining yourself a little bit. I know it's probably just a high note. My vocal coach would come up to me and press his fingers, and he'd be like, can I touch you? And he'd press my diaphragm, and he said, he always wants me to just, like, naturally tell it, like, if I feel like I'm going, or, like, you know, tensing or being like that, like, and hearing you kind of sing a little bit tense on this, just because it's a high note, I understand.
Yeah.
But I guess what I'm saying is just try to be natural and loose about it. It's sounding fucking amazing.
Hold my hand and lead me. Lead me away from here.
Sounds great.
Lock.
Lock it in. I think we got it. Let's go listen.
Yep. We recorded 22 songs in 5 days for this record. And that came out of a list of about 70 tunes. At first, I would call Dad and I'd say, hey, write down some songs, you know?
Yeah.
And I'd write down my list and we'd compare them. And when we were in the studio, I just kind of picked them out, like whichever ones I felt like playing that day or which were most important. The ones that I felt, you know, that I remember most from my childhood.
Mm-hmm.
The ones that really paint a portrait of my childhood and the ones that give me deja vu.
Hold my hand and lead me.
You know, well, there is that song. It used to make me cry so bad. I'd be in the very back of our tour van, you know, going down some highway at 1 o'clock in the morning after a gig with my iPod listening to that song, thinking about my dad with tears rolling down, you know, secretly crying back there. And that song, it's so beautiful and sad at the same time. And I never really thought about how in the song, you know, that it is about a relationship between a father and son. So
mm-hmm.
I never really thought about maybe that's why it reminds me of you so much and makes me cry.
Wow.
Lost all my money but a $2 bill, boys, $2 bill. Lost all my money but a $2 bill, I'm on my long journey home.
You know, we recorded 22 songs, but then I kind of narrowed it down to these ones so we could fit it on a vinyl and make it into a record, you know, and it starts with Long Journey Home. That's one of the first songs I ever learned, and so I put that at the beginning. It's almost, you know, it's not chronological, I don't think, but at least it starts off that way. It's one of the very first songs I ever learned.
Looks like some rain, looks like some rain, boys, looks like some rain.
When he was real small, I told him and his brother, he goes, there's a special coming on tonight on Austin City Limits, and it's Larry Sparks. We got to hear Larry. And that's when I fell in love with that, the John Deere tractor song, when he did it, but then I did it. And he does it.
And I watched those happened. Tapes. He, you know, yeah. he recorded
yeah.
Doc and Larry Sparks and a couple other Austin City Limits, Bill Monroe and stuff, Stanley Brothers. And so I don't know what tape they were on. It was like some old Sylvester Stallone movie or whatever. But when you put it in, it was actually Larry Sparks and yeah. Bill Monroe and shit.
Yeah.
He learned them off the record, mm-hmm. so he does them pretty close to that. But it's still, he's got his little flavor in it, and I. Learn from him, so I maybe put my little flavor on it.
Sure.
So even if we're doing a Stanley Brothers song or something like Stone Walls and Steel Bars or something, I think we're doing the Barker's Park version. Is you know,
exactly.
That.
We always put a little different flavor on the song, you know, like he said, not to try to do it exactly, because that's not going to happen at all.
Yeah, because we can't. We can't. We're not that slick. You know, but we do our little version of, mm-hmm. of it, you know, and then, of course it's inspired by the originals, you know.
Right.
Dude, that's so fatty style dobro right there, bro.
like John Deere Tractor, it's kind of interesting that one because I feel like that one's sort of taken on its own soul a little bit. In a way, it's grown in our sort of sound a little bit. Like when I listen to Larry Sparks. And him play it. It's a little different than how mm-hmm. I did. It's almost like the telephone game. Mm. Over time, you know, it gets passed around a little bit, changes, you know, as you go.
Yeah.
It's still the same song, but it's got a little bit of different flavor here and there. I love that.
What extraordinary artists we had. We got the McCurry brothers, and Jerry Douglas came in for a couple. Everybody was beautiful. We was all right on key. I mean, it was like all done right. To me, it was right on.
Yeah.
I wanted to get, you know, Bub and stuff because I had hung with Bub and heard him tell awesome Bill Monroe stories and stuff like that. And Ronnie and Rob, they just been around with Del forever. And you know, these are just school of hard knocks, bluegrass cats, you know, been there, done that sort of folks, and just all that. And Michael Cleveland, I knew that you'd love him.
Oh, he is a beautiful man, yep.
Yeah, he's sweet.
Yep.
Amazing players all around. There was minimal overdubbing, you know. The guys are just so badass that we just didn't really have to do anything besides play the songs actually live. Play with anyone like I can play with you. I can't.
And I can't either. Forget about it. I gotta be.
I can't sing with anyone like I can sing
with him. When I play alone, I play alone. But when I'm with him, we play together. And I've been with other musicians, and I love them dearly. They're good friends and all that, but they just don't hold a candle to him. He knows each step I take.
Yeah, in a way, if I resemble his characteristics of, you know, hopefully I can play like him.
Yeah.
And that's another good reason for this record is because I always want that. I mean, I want to carry on your sound, which is a specific thing. He's part of a dying breed of bluegrass musicians that you don't really hear anymore. You know, sometime in the late 70s and 80s, I mean, the sound was kind of modernized in a bit, and it seems like less and less you hear people play the old way, like the old mountain sound or you know, more Stanley Brothers and Monroe and Flat and Scruggs sounded.
Beautiful.
And he just has that. And I think it's just important for people to hear that as well, you know.
Church in the valley, little white church is a place I love so well. I'm sad and lonely, yes I am sad and lonely for the little white church in the valley.
These songs, they are older, you know, and they remind me of Grandma Doreen and stuff, and Grandma Connie, the Little White Church in the Valley.
Yes.
Little White Church in the Valley, Grandma made us play that song every time.
Mm-hmm.
If we came over to visit, we had to get our guitars out before we left and at least play that song before we left.
For the Little White Church in the
Dad's Martin, you know, which is the guitar he played on the whole record. That's the guitar he's had forever, for as long as I've can remember.
Many moons, yes. My dad bought that for me.
Yeah, so when did that happen? He bought you and Bub guitars, right?
Yeah.
What, he win the lottery or something?
No, he sued. My stepmother's leg got cut off.
Oh, wow.
But she was diabetic, and they cut the wrong leg. So he, yeah. And I don't know, he was passing away, sort of, you know. And he, in my heart and soul, he wanted to do something for me and my brother. So he comes to Michigan, he's from Florida, comes to Michigan to see us all. It's almost like a farewell thing, you know, but it wasn't then. But anyway, let's go to your favorite music store. I want to buy you and your brother guitars. So we go to Elderly, which is my favorite. I'm sitting there, I'm looking around, you know, and I picked out the old Martin there, right? And I'm playing it. I sat there for probably 40 minutes. He goes, why are you taking so long with this one? I goes, I think I like this. I think I might want. He goes, what about them out there? You know, he's pointing at Les Pauls and Stratocasters. I goes, I don't do that no more, Dad. I played this. And he goes, well, if that's what you want, son, that's what you want. We went home to my mother's at that point, and your grandma was sitting there talking to him, Grandma Connie. And I got that Martin, I started playing, and I played the Little White Church. As I'm playing, I looked over, and every one of them, my mom, my dad, and Connie, all just tears are falling, which was joyous.
And you sold it to provide for your family.
Yes. Something got behind, like water and lights, and I didn't have the money then, so I kind of sold back to Elderly. And I paid my bills, and at the same time thinking I'm gonna get it back, you know, I'll go make payments on it. But they somehow, something got mixed up and it got sold, and it was gone. I thought, well, that's the end of it.
That guitar when I was little, you know, like, was the guitar that I sat in front of to learn. And I had a dream about having that guitar someday, you know, and that it would be something that I could always play and remember my dad, like long after he passes away, and it's, you know, he told me, you know, son, someday when I die, this will be your guitar.
Yes, right.
It's like I built the dream upon, you know, someday taking care of that thing. And, you know, it was Dad's Martin. It was the family jewel. It was the one thing of, you know, extreme value, both sentimental and, you know, that was worth anything that we really had. So when he had to sell it, I was really kind of terrified. Like, don't, you know, we'll figure it out. Don't sell it. But he had to do what he had to do. And, you know, and 7 years passed. I had went through this whole heavy metal phase, kind of wasn't even playing acoustic guitar anymore. I was just kind of rambling around, playing in metal bands and shit, partying. And eventually, I kind of just fell off from that. I started really getting back into bluegrass real heavy, so I wanted an acoustic guitar really bad. And I started searching online, and I just came across my dad's guitar online. And I started sending this guy emails and stuff saying, you know, hey, this is my dad's guitar and his dad bought it for him and it's supposed to be mine someday and I need you, please don't sell it to anybody but me. And he's like, didn't really believe me, I guess, at first, you know, and was like, how do I know you're not just talking shit? You know, you're 17 years old and you don't have the money, and I have three people on eBay right now with cash. And he didn't really take at first. And his
Massachusetts, don't forget that part.
Yeah. He was in Massachusetts, this guy. And then his wife, Marla, stepped in and was kind of like, hey, man, like, I read your message and it's super special and I'm not going to let him sell it, you know. So I'm like, can we do a payment plan? And they're like, oh, come on, you know, I don't know. And so I talked him into doing it, you know, $700 a month for 3 months. He wanted $2,100 for the guitar. I was pissed broke. So I was taking back pop bottles and selling bags of weed and doing whatever I had to do to come up with $700 a month for 3 months. And sent him the money for 3 months in a row. And he sent my dad's guitar back to me, and I took it back over to dad's and sat it on the table. And he's like, what the fuck is that? You know, he thought
I couldn't believe it.
He thought it was a prank.
I goes, what are you doing? What is this? Go ahead.
So he, you know, kind of sits there and puts his hand on the case. And I'm like, well, are you going to open it? And he undoes one latch at a time, and he opens it like 2 inches, you know, and just kind of closes it again, and we all start crying. So eventually he pulls the guitar out and plays John Deere Tractor on it, and we all just lost it.
It's a nice old Martin. So is that one too, though, by golly.
They like singing together.
Yeah, they definitely do that.
No, I can't be free to go and see the ones that I love so. I've been in here 18 years. I still got life to go.
Originally, I was gonna be the one singing lead on that particular song. And we jumped in there, and I maybe sang it a little bit, and then he just kind of started singing lead on it.
I couldn't help it.
And it was, because he knew, you know?
Yeah.
Just, it worked out. I think it was supposed to be that way. We've done these songs forever, but some of them, you know, sometimes I'll sing lead, sometimes he'll sing
lead. I'll want him too, or vice versa. But
like when we were doing the tour, you know, that would just happen. It's like we start
it's
a song,
and
we get to the part where somebody needs to sing, and we just kind of look at each other, and it's like, you or me? Well, okay, well, I'll take it, you know?
I heard my mother weeping.
He goes, you think we'll get Ma down studio this morning? I goes, give me the phone.
Yeah, she, I feel like, was nervous and stuff. And, you know, that song.
Oh, definitely.
That song, I remember hearing it. Like, I remember kind of sneaking up beside you guys' bedroom door, and the door was closed, and him and her were in there singing it, you know? And just,
I
remember it being so beautiful, you know? It's just such a family album. I thought, you know, well, there is that song. And to me, it was always going to be the last song on the record. It just was a nice way to close it.
I think that's a wrap on the record!
Congratulations, son.
It's a me and my dad record, you know. It fits right at the top or at the bottom. Maybe it's at the foundation down here. Everything else is sprinkled on top. All my records and stuff. This is like the main one. It's what I cut my teeth on. It's you can't get more back to your roots than this. I mean, these songs are how I learned how to play music. Some of these songs I probably was playing before I could tie my shoes. I don't want to say tribute, you know, I'm not going to bury him while he yet lives, but I mean it's just reverence and respect. It's a thank you, you know. It's a thank you for showing me the way to a good life.
In our little cabin home.